Spirit. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for everyone gathered here now. Today, Lord Jesus, again we choose to surrender ourselves once again and quench ourselves once again in this love of yours. Thank you, Lord, for not giving up on us and not staying angry despite the number of times we choose to hurt you. We say that we are dependent on you and we trust, our trust is in you completely. And as we surrender ourselves now in adoration, we ask that you would come by your Holy Spirit and inspire our hearts again today. Come fill our life with your love, fill our conversation with your grace and truth. Fill this meeting with your presence. We ask this for your glory and praise.
Amen. 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 Thank you, Sister Joyce, for leading us into a beautiful prayer. And brothers and sisters, a warm welcome to each one of you. Today we are going to reflect on the day's gospel from Mark chapter 10, verses 28 to 31. So today's gospel is from Mark chapter 10, verses 28 to 31. And you know, my brothers and sisters, before we get into today's gospel passage, let me just give you a bit of a recap or a background before we go to this verse. Because you know, when you pick up a gospel somewhere in between, there is a very good likelihood of us that you're going to find yourself a little bit confused, you won't understand the context of the passage, and as a result, you will find that you will not be able to get the full impact of that particular passage. So, you know, brothers and sisters, before we go to today's passage, let me explain to you what happens. Jesus has been talking to the people around. There has been a rich young man who has come to Jesus. And he comes to Jesus with the question, and he says, "Lord, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And you know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus tells him, you know, go and sell everything you have and then come and follow me. And you know, my brothers and sisters, as soon as Jesus tells this young man, leave everything, sell off everything and come and follow me, the man just leaves Jesus and he goes away completely sad. Why? Because he had his life totally built on his riches. You know, it's something like this. People have got a lot of wealth with them. They've got a lot of money. They've got a good bank balance. They've got a house. They've got their cars. They've got all their luxuries of this life. And you know, my brothers and sisters, when a person is having all that, is it easy for a person to come to God and to really start worshiping God? I'm not saying that there are people who have got all these things and they don't come to God. But when a person has never known God, but they have so much of wealth, either through inheritance or it has been dropped for them, you know, they have just had been born with the golden spoon, as they say, because their parents have basically, you know, earned a lot of wealth. In such a background, is it really easy for somebody to come to the Lord and to leave all those luxuries and come to Jesus? It is extremely difficult. And this is exactly the situation with this young man. He was extremely rich and he comes to Jesus. He says, "Jesus, what must I do in order to inherit eternal life?" He thought that he could do something on his own because he had a lot of wealth with him. Maybe Jesus would have told him, you know, give some of your wealth to the poor, do some charity work, say your prayers regularly, and then, you know, it'll be fine with you. You'll be able to inherit eternal life. But the question that Jesus addresses is not about what he could do, but Jesus told him, the very God of your life. What was the God of his life? His money was his God. And you know, my brothers and sisters, the moment this rich man had God as his money, he was not ready to let this God go from his life. He was not ready to let go of his riches, because his riches and his money was an impediment for him to receive eternal life. And today, as we begin this reflection, let us ask ourselves, is there anything in our life that is an impediment for us to have a relationship with Jesus? You know, my brothers and sisters, it could be our job, it could be our hobbies, it could be our money, it could be our mobile phone, it could be our computer, it could be our car, it could be our spouse, it could be our children, it can be anything that's going to come in between us and God. And the moment there is anything between God and us, it's surely going to be an impediment for us to have eternal life, to have this relationship with Jesus. Because when you want to have a relationship with Jesus, you must be so single-minded that you say, Lord, I have you first in my life, your word comes first in my life, and therefore, if there is anything that you can show me which I am giving more attention than you, help me, Lord, to start focusing on you more, so that slowly but surely you will also allow me to love those things in a much profound way than what I'm doing right now. Remember, my brothers and sisters, loving your spouse, loving your children, loving your family, looking after your house and looking after all that you have been given as a steward is not wrong. It is absolutely correct, but it has to be done in the right perspective. We need to understand whatever has been given to us, whether it is our very own life, the very breath that we have, if that is more precious to us, survival and, you know, wanting to live for a long life, that is our only goal in this life, then there is something drastically wrong with us, because we are not going to be trusting God enough for us to have a relationship with Him, for Him to speak to us so that we can fulfill the very purpose we have been put into this life. And remember, my brothers and sisters, the moment we begin to put God first, the moment He comes first in our life, this God who has created us wants us to experience heaven here on earth. So, you know, the topic that I said here, what we addressed, what I sent you as an invitation is living or experiencing heaven here on earth. And the only time we will experience heaven here on earth, we will experience the peace of God in our hearts. We will experience that peace of mind. We will begin to experience the abundant blessings. And also persecutions and opposition in our life, we will begin to experience heaven here on earth plus persecutions. But at the end of it, we will be also able to experience Christ and the life of God on this planet earth. So when today we are going to take the gospel passage, we are going to see Peter going to ask Jesus a question. In Mark chapter 10 verse 28, we're not going to go there yet, but before we go to Mark chapter 10 verse 28, you know, Jesus tells in verse number 25, He tells the disciples and all those who are around, He tells them, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. No, look at what Jesus is saying. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. And you know, my sisters and brothers, we all know how much we struggle to put a fine thread inside the eye of a needle. And Jesus is talking about a camel, which is so huge, it is much easier for that camel to pass through the eye of a needle. And we know a camel can never pass through the eye of a needle. But if Jesus is saying it is easier for a camel that is so huge to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, it only indicates that to enter the kingdom of heaven is not going to be everybody's cup of tea. It's not going to be easy, because there is a test, there is a path to be followed before we can enter the kingdom of heaven. And you know, my brothers and sisters, as soon as Jesus in verse number 25 tells those disciples, tells all those people around, because by then the rich man had already gone away, you know what happens? In verse number 26, they were all astounded and said to one another, who then can be saved? Who then can be saved? And then Jesus looks to them and He says, for mortals it is impossible. For human beings it is impossible. But for God, all things are possible. And you know, my brothers and sisters, what was Jesus trying to tell the disciples at that time? He was saying, although I have told you that it is difficult for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle, and in the physical, it seems so difficult for you to ever imagine that happening, As much as it is so difficult for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle, it is impossible. Nobody can do that. He's saying it is easier for a camel to pass than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because a rich person is always going to make their riches their wealth. So does that mean it is not good to be rich? Is it good to be living a powerful, a life of poverty? Absolutely, again, that is also not true, because God wants his people to live in prosperity. He wants to them to live in the prosperity of heaven. He wants them to live in the abundant life that he has promised us. So, you know, my sisters and brothers, before we go to verse number 28, I needed to explain to you the background of this particular chapter in Mark chapter 10, so that now when we come to verse number 28, we will begin to understand the context in what Peter is asking Jesus this question. So let us go to Mark chapter 10, verse number 28.
Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you."
Now, because Jesus talked about entering the kingdom of God, you know, it was difficult for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. He was talking about how difficult it was. Peter turns around to Jesus and he says, "Look, Jesus, look, Lord, we have left everything and followed you. What about us?" And you know, sisters and brothers, these words of Peter came after Jesus had said to the rich young man, you know, leave everything and follow me. You know, what Peter had said came from these thoughts that were running in Peter's mind after Jesus had said concerning those who could enter the kingdom of heaven. And you know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus had just said to the rich man and to all those people that those who trusted in riches couldn't enter the kingdom of heaven. Those who trusted their riches, those who trusted their education, their degrees, their home, their car, any material thing that came in their way, if they trusted it more than God, surely they were disqualified to enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, my brothers and sisters, Peter, on the other hand, after hearing what Jesus was saying, was making it clear to Jesus that he and all the other disciples had left everything to follow Jesus. They had left everything to follow Jesus, because he's saying, "Look, Jesus, we have left everything to follow you." So what is this everything that Peter was talking about? What was he referring to, this everything? The first thing I'm sure Peter would have left everything was, he would have left his family. He would have left his wife, because he had a mother-in-law. So surely he had a wife. He would have had even children, which were depending on him. Remember, Peter was also a fisherman. You know, Peter used to earn his livelihood by going out fishing. And so, if he went the whole night to fish, and then in the morning, probably his wife or somebody would buy the fish and sell it so that he could get his lunch, breakfast, dinner, at least his livelihood. Now that he was going to be serving Jesus, who would be going out fishing? Who would be able to sell all those things? Who would be able to bring the money to them? So Peter had even left his livelihood. The third thing that Peter would have done is, he would have entrusted his entire future in the hands of Jesus. Remember, this is because now they were following Jesus and they had abandoned their past life. They had actually exchanged their life in order to follow Jesus and his kingdom. And so, brothers and sisters, when Peter is telling Jesus, "We have left everything to follow you," he was talking about leaving his family, his wife, his children, his in-laws, all his brothers and sisters, his near and dear ones. Probably he could have, you know, after he went fishing, he would have probably done a little bit of, you know, gone and seen his friends, gone to the market, had a chat. There could have been so much of fellowship with people whom he was doing all this while. Secondly, he could have also, you know, gave up his livelihood in order to, you know, earn that bread for his family. And then about his future. Now, where is the money going to come from? What about my livelihood? What about my family? But all these things, Peter and the disciples had given up in order to follow Jesus. And that's exactly the question that Peter addresses to Jesus. He says, "Lord, we have left everything in order to follow you." Let's go to verses 29 and 30 together to see what is Jesus's response. Remember, He has already spoken to the rich man. He has given a teaching to them that, you know, if riches come and there is anything that is going to come between him and us, we are absolutely going to be disqualified. Now look at what Jesus says in verse number 29 and 30.
Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life."
Now, brothers and sisters, as you read verses 29 and 30, there is so much that we can learn, and we are going to dwell a little bit longer on these two verses. You know, when we read Mark's gospel, there is not the complete details. That's why a particular incident or particular teaching, when we go to the other synoptic gospels, we will find that there'll be more information, and as a result, we will understand the entire incident, the entire teaching that took place. So, for example, in this particular case, we are reading the gospel of Jesus having this encounter, or the rich man having an encounter with Jesus. But in Matthew's gospel, we find that Matthew has added some more details. I want to take you to Matthew chapter 19, verse number 28. Matthew chapter 19, verse number 28. Matthew is adding some more details in this teaching of Jesus. Let us see what Jesus adds apart from what he said in Mark chapter 10, verses 29 and 30.
Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man is seated on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel."
Now, brothers and sisters, Matthew adds this particular thing in Matthew 19 verse 28. He tells the disciples, when the time of judgment comes, when the Son of Man returns, all of you will be sitting on the 12 on the thrones on for the representing the 12 tribes of Israel, and you will be sitting and judging people. You will be judging the 12 tribes of Israel. You know, my sisters and brothers, this gives us another idea of the judgment. You know, we all talked about when Jesus returns, he will be separating the sheep from the goats. But you know, my sisters and brothers, this verse is again telling us that we will be judging the unbelievers when Jesus returns again. All of us who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ will not have any judgment. We will not be judged because the judgment was already given to Jesus. He was judged because we believed in him. And therefore, the judgment that Jesus received for us on the cross of Calvary, when we believed in his blood, we will not be judged, but we'll be assisting Jesus along with the 12 tribes of Israel, judging the unbelievers. The unbelievers will be judged. That is why, even in the book of Romans, St. Paul says, do not take vengeance on against anybody, because God says, my vengeance is mine. And therefore, brothers and sisters, even the people of God today who are going through so much of persecution, who are going through so much of hardships, they will have their day of vengeance on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, my brothers and sisters, there were 12 disciples. There were these 12 disciples of Jesus, and they were given the promise of 12 thrones. And you know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus didn't mention any conditions to the disciples, how this will occur or when this will occur. But you know, my brothers and sisters, some must have even been implied for. For example, you know, when Jesus said to them, you will all be sitting on the 12 tribes and judging the 12 tribes of Israel, you must understand this. Judas was the man who was exempted from all this. Judas is not going to sit on one of the 12 thrones, because Judas condemned himself, and right now he's burning in hell. Remember, Judas rejected the love of God. So Judas, on his own free will, rejected Jesus And therefore, the 12 thrones and the 12 tribes of Israel will not have Judas, but it will have another person or have other people who believed in Jesus, who one day will be judging the unbelievers. So let us go back to verse number 30. Verse number 30 tells us that we who are believing in Jesus, who have, you know, left houses, homes, families, left properties, we will receive a hundredfold now. That's what it says in verse number 30. We shall receive a hundredfold now, that it says. And you know, my sisters and brothers, this is not a promise to everyone, you know, who has suffered loss in this life so that they can receive everything back with interest. No, 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 no. This is not what it's saying. Because many people think, because I lost so much in my life, God is going to bless me a lot of things in my life because of what I lost. Please understand, just because you lost a lot of things and now you come to this verse, you're going to receive a hundredfold. That's not what it is saying. This is a promise specifically to those who did all these things for Jesus' sake and for the sake of the gospel. What are these things? You know, Jesus is saying all these things. What are these things? You will receive a hundredfold. You will receive a hundredfold from the Lord. What is this hundredfold? What are these things that you have left for? Left everything for the gospel, to share the good news to others so that they can be saved by hearing the message of Jesus. You know, my brothers and sisters, many of us would like to have the benefits of all that is offered to us, but we are not prepared to do the conditions. For example, if you go to the supermarket, and in the supermarket there is an offer, buy two, get one free. Can you basically tell the shop, the person at the supermarket, please give me the two free, I don't want the third one? Can you ever do that? You have to buy two so that you can get the one free. It's only one when you buy the two that you get the one free. In the same way, when you and I decide to make Jesus our Lord, God and Savior, we make Him number one in our life. We decide for His sake that we are going to put everything aside in order to make Him the Lord God of our life. Then everything is going to return to us a hundredfold. And what is this hundredfold we are going to receive? Let us go back to verse number 30. It says, those who left for the sake of, for my sake and for the sake of the good news, they will receive a hundredfold in this age. What is this hundredfold? They will receive houses. They will receive brothers. They will receive sisters. They will receive mothers. They will receive children. They will receive fields, along with persecution. You know, my sisters and brothers, many of us don't want to read about the persecution, but we want to have lots of brothers and sisters. You know, the moment you begin to share the gospel, you are going to be a brother and sister to believers. Remember, why do we address each other as brother and sister? Because we are brothers and sisters in Christ. Christ is our brother, big brother. God has become our heavenly Father. And if we believe in Jesus, then we are brothers and sisters to one another. There are people in our life who become our mothers. How do they become our mothers? They begin to show us love. They begin to show us that extra affection which our own mothers gave us, and even much more, because we are sharing the good news to them. What about children? There are people to whom you will become a spiritual father, a spiritual mother to those who are really growing. This is not talking about little babies. This is not talking about little children. This is talking about those who become your children, just like Timothy became a child of Saint Paul. Timothy was a child. Saint Paul always calls Timothy as my precious child. I became a father to him, he says, a spiritual father. And so we become spiritual fathers, we become spiritual mothers to people when we share the gospel to them. And then he says, they will also receive fields, they will receive so much of blessings. What is the meaning of this, my brothers and sisters? The blessings will come upon you when you begin to share the gospel. When people begin to receive the gospel, they begin to get blessed by, because of the good news that they have heard. They will also share with you their goodness. They will also share their blessings because of the word that they receive. And that's exactly what it says. But at the same time, with all these things, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and property, and all the luxuries that come with life, you will also receive persecution. Remember, my brothers and sisters, this is something that not everybody is very happy about. Because you know what? We all want to receive all the good things, but we are not ready to get persecuted for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, brothers and sisters, there will be persecutions to go along with God's blessings as well. Remember, these persecutions are not going to come from God, but they are sure going to come. What is the meaning of this? Whenever you belong to the kingdom of God, there are definitely going to be persecution. People are going to come against you. It's a truth, because when you belong to the kingdom of God, you're going to encounter people who belong to the kingdom of darkness or belong to the kingdom of this world. Their priorities are not going to have Christ as their number one. They're going to have other priorities as well. And the moment you begin to share the gospel, they are going to come against you. They're going to say, who you think you are? I'm already blessed. I'm already going to church. I'm already having a great relationship. I've got a great church. I even got my name engraved on the benches of the church. I've got a little, you know, place, a hole made for the family, all the remains of our families to be even put in the church walls. So you don't tell me much about the gospel. We are well connected to our church, so don't you tell me anything about it, and they will persecute you, they will even reject you. But you know, my sisters and brothers, the persecutions that come will not come from God, but they surely will come. Why? You know, persecutions are supposed to be an indication that you and I are making an impact in the kingdom of God. We are making a difference in the kingdom of God, and unless we understand this, we will definitely not embrace persecution. There are times we have to endure persecutions. There are times we have to get away from that particular persecution, because at the end of it, we are called, persecution as believers becomes our birthright. So brothers and sisters, what is Jesus talking about persecution in verse number 30? These are not just general persecutions, although they too can come. What do you mean by general persecution? Let us go to 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse number 12, 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse number 12, because Saint Paul is writing the letter to Timothy, and he's telling Timothy in the second book of Timothy, chapter 3 verse 12, about what happens to the godly. What happens to the godly? Let us read that.
Indeed, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted.
All those who want to live a godly life will be persecuted. Remember, my brothers and sisters, this is all talking about general persecution. But you know, in this particular verse, when Jesus talked about, you know, receiving brothers, sisters, mothers, children, fields, and everything, and persecution, he was specifically talking about persecution because of God's abundant hundredfold blessings. Many of you will be surprised. Are you saying because we are going to be blessed, because of the abundant blessings, people are going to persecute us? Yes, that is exactly what this verse is saying. You know, my brothers and sisters, when these blessings begin to manifest in our lives, people will begin to persecute us. There is going to be persecution against us from people because of envy, because of jealousy, because of so many other factors. There is a prejudice against Christians, especially those who proclaim God's word, because they become suddenly blessed. You know, if you're really proclaiming the word of God, if you're really serving the Lord, you have kept everything aside, you have actually put aside everything to serve the living God, there is going to be a tremendous amount of blessings. There is going to be a tremendous amount of abundance in your life. And you know, my brothers and sisters, many people believe today that Christians, and especially those who share the gospel, should be poor. I don't know if you ever heard that. You know, if you believe that there is anybody who's sharing the gospel, he should be, if he's suddenly, you know, living a very good life, people are going to raise their eyebrows and say, how come that preacher is living such a great life? How come he's driving good cars? How come he's, you know, he's living a great life? Because a preacher is supposed to live in poverty according to this understanding of this world. But you know, my brothers and sisters, the gospel itself is prosperous. And a man of God who's truly serving the Lord, not waiting on the riches to come, he is a person who has made God his priority. And therefore, God begins to bless such a person, so that person who's blessed becomes a blessing to others. Please understand, God is not blessing you because he wants you to be selfish. God is blessing you so that you in turn can be a blessing to others. And a person who is sowing the word of God is bound to be blessed, is bound to be prosperous. And you know, my brothers and sisters, let me say this to you very clearly. If you and I are sharing the good news, if you and I are truly, you know, proclaiming the gospel, and we are ashamed or even embarrassed to proclaim God's blessings in our life because of persecution, because people will raise their eyebrows and say, how come that person is living so well? You know, it will limit how the Lord can bless us. There are so many people today who are so blessed, but they do not want to tell everybody how blessed they are because they are afraid somebody will approach them, somebody will tell them, you know, how come you have earned so much of money? How come you are so blessed? But you know, my sisters and brothers, a true person, a true believer of the Lord Jesus Christ is bound to be blessed because Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief comes to kill, to steal and to destroy, but I have come so that you may have life and have it to the fullest. He wants us to have life to the fullest, my brothers and sisters. And you know, my brothers and sisters, when people who are reluctant or hesitant to speak of God's blessings on their life because of the fear of how others will, you know, receive that news, they are operating in the fear of man. You know, when somebody operates based on what others are going to think of them, they are going to operate because of the fear of what others are going to say. That fear of man is the snare of the devil. That's what the Proverbs chapter 29 verse number 25 says. Proverbs chapter 29 verse number 25. Let us read that.
The fear of others lays a snare, but one who trusts in the Lord is secure.
The fear of man brings a snare, but those who trust in the Lord are safe. You know, my brothers and sisters, please understand, the fear of others lays a snare, but one who trusts in the Lord is absolutely secure. Why is somebody secure in the Lord? Because they know that it is not security of people. They are not dependent on people. They are dependent on the Lord. And the Lord, whom you and I serve with a sincere heart, he knows how to bless his children. He knows how to give us an abundance. He knows how to make our barns overflow. But our focus, even the barns are overflowing, should never make us go to the barns that are overflowing, but continue to serve the Lord so that what we are blessed with, we can be a blessing to others. Remember, my brothers and sisters, when we studied about the parable of the sower and the seed, you know, the third seed is the one which fell among the thorny bushes. It's the third seed that fell among the thorny bushes. And when the plant began to grow, the plant began to get choked. But you know, my brothers and sisters, it began to get choked. And the reason Jesus said was because of the riches of this world, because of all the, you're past the first two tests, you've started believing the word. Now the blessings are coming upon you. And now because the blessings are coming upon you, you have forgotten the blesser and started running after your blessing. So many people today in God's kingdom, they saw the glory, they saw the blessings flow because they believed the word. And eventually, when they got their job, when they received their miracle, they said, bye bye Jesus, see you till the next problem comes. And as a result, they found themselves, the worldly lures, the worldly riches, the worldly ambitions, all that they received, the name and fame that they received, slowly took them away from the Creator, took them away from the source of blessing, and now they are living a miserable life. You know, my sisters and brothers, please understand, the Lord wants to bless his children. The Lord wants us to live as though we are heaven on earth. Everything provided, an abundant life. But we must not boast in ourselves. Never boast in ourselves. But we should boast in the Lord and what he has done in our life. That's exactly what Psalm 34 verse number 2 says. And again in Psalm 44 verse 8. Let us go and read Psalm 34 verse number 2.
My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad.
My soul makes its boast in the Lord. My soul doesn't make my boast in myself. I'm not a self-made man. There are a lot of people who say, I'm a self-made man. I have worked hard. I have studied hard. I used the little candles and I worked hard. I worked my way up to the top. And now I am enjoying the fruit of all my labor. You know, my sisters and brothers, Those people who talk that sort of a language are just opening themselves to a big, big opening of disaster in their life, because they are claiming the glory, they are claiming all that credit based on their own performance. Our soul needs to boast in what the Lord has done. What about Psalm 44, verse number 8?
In God we have boasted continually, and we will give thanks to your name forever.
Can we read that again, please, very slowly?
In God we have boasted continually, and we will give thanks to your name forever.
In God we will continue to boast continuously, and we'll continue to give him thanks forever. You know, my brothers and sisters, when we understand that at this very moment we are breathing free oxygen, there is food on our table, we have a good night's rest, we are able to listen to God's word, we are able to, you know, live a life of freedom in Christ Jesus, every single moment is a moment to give thanks to the Lord. And you know, sisters and brothers, please understand this. When you and I begin to receive prosperity, when you and I begin to live the abundant life, doing that will bring persecution from those who are offended by our prosperity. Please understand, people are going to be offended when we become prosperous in Christ Jesus. Because when you and I become prosperous in Christ Jesus, we are not going to hoard it to ourselves. We are not going to keep the blessings to ourselves. We are not going to store it in barns. But the more we get blessed, the more we become givers of others. Because we are going to use that wealth in order to proclaim the gospel. We are going to use our wealth in order to advance the kingdom. Remember this. There is a difference between Christian giving, there is a difference between secular giving. There is a difference between Christian giving, there is a difference between humanitarian giving. When you give, do a Christian giving because you are blessed, you are going to give it so that through your giving, you are going to find an opening for you to share the gospel. You are going to find an opening for you to give the good news to that place. There are so many people today who want to give their money to organizations, because right now the COVID has come. They all want to do something. They want to give somebody food to eat. They want to give somebody money. They want to do their part so that they can feel good. Let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, don't be ruled by your emotions. Don't be ruled by requests that come in. Let the Holy Spirit lead you, so that when you put in your money or put in your seed, let that seed become an opening for you in order to enter that place, in order to share the gospel, so that the people who receive your seed will not look to you as their source, but they'll begin to look to the Lord of heaven and earth as their source, as they begin to hear the gospel, as they begin to hear the good news. Remember, this scripture, my brothers and sisters, like many other scriptures, has been misapplied, has also been misunderstood and used by many to justify, you know, covetousness or simply greed. It has simply been misused. It has been very badly misunderstood. You know, that was not Jesus' intent. Jesus never intended to use this verse that way, as can be seen by his words to the rich young man. He told the rich young man, he says, please, you know, get this thing out of your life. Get this wealth which you have been adoring as your God out of your life, and come and follow me. And then you're going to receive much more than what you already have. You know, my brothers and sisters, it all comes down to our motives. Our motives should never, ever be selfish. You know, if you are really a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ, everything that we do, everything that we say, our motive should be very clear, because God understands our motive. And you know, sisters and brothers, whatever you do, whether you serve the Lord, whether you come to the Lord for doing anything, let your motive only be because of love, because of the love that you have received from the Father. And when you give love, love is going to come back to you in multiplication. So when you sow love in a particular place, don't just sow your seed, but ensure that the person you are sowing your seed is also going to receive eternal life, is also going to receive the gospel. What is the use if you are going to feed people their stomachs, but don't give them Christ? What are they going to do after this life? They are going to go to hell without Christ. But when you sow your seed, ensure that you also are able to share the gospel. You are able to give the good news to that place, so that your seed becomes for you an opening to share the gospel, to give the good news of what has inspired you to share your seed in that place. If you are just sharing from your surplus, please don't do it. If you are going to show it from your surplus, don't do it, because God doesn't want your extras. He wants something which you really gave out of your love by really making it less for yourself. So brothers and sisters, whatever be the case, irrespective of how people are using the scripture and how they are interpreting it, Jesus did promise a hundredfold return in this present time. He said, in this present time, meaning right here on earth now, in the right now as we hear, he wants his children to receive a hundredfold blessings. Amen. Mark chapter 10, verse number 31. Let's go to our final verse for today.
But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first.
Many who are first now will be last, and the last will be first. You know, if you go to again to Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 19, and again if you go to Luke's Gospel, Luke chapter 18, there also it is recorded that about Peter's statement about Jesus. You know, Peter said the same thing to Jesus when Jesus told him, you know, it's easy for a camel to pass through an eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And you know, my brothers and sisters, there are two other times in the Gospel when Jesus said the same thing about the first being last and the last being first. Again, in Matthew chapter 20 and Luke chapter 13. But you know, in Matthew chapter 20, when Jesus was talking, you know, he was talking about the Gentiles sharing equally with the Jews. You know, at that time, when Jesus walked on the earth, the Jews thought that everybody else is going to hell, only they are the ones who are going to have eternal life. And they were so, you know, they were so wrong about it, because they themselves did not believe in Jesus. They themselves, even though Jesus was born in the land of Israel, they had rejected Jesus. And they thought that just because they had a covenant with God through circumcision, they were the ones who were only going to receive eternal life. And what did Jesus say to them in Matthew chapter 20? He said to them that the Gentiles would be sharing equally with the Jews. You know, in fact, in Matthew chapter 20, verse number 16, he says, let the last become first and the first become last. And then again, if you look at the entire parable in Matthew chapter 20 verses 1 to 15, it is an explanation of the first being last and the last being first. And therefore, my brothers and sisters, this verse in verse number 31 in Mark chapter 10 verse number 31 is speaking of the Jews who had the first of the things of God at one time. They were the ones who received the good news. They were the ones who had the prophets come and speak to them. They had Jesus who was born in their homeland. But becoming last was what? Because the Gentiles who were last, like you and us who are the Gentiles, we were not belonging to the land of Israel. But now we have become one with Christ. We are the Gentiles. We are the ones who were the last, although the Jews were the first. And now we are going to become first in entering the kingdom of God. But now, when we all Gentiles have received the word of God, you know what it means? It means exactly what Jesus tried to explain in Matthew chapter 20 verses 1 to 15. You know, in Matthew chapter 20 verses 1 to 15, very quickly I will want to explain this last becoming first and first becoming last. Jesus was giving a parable in Matthew chapter 20 verses 1 to 15. He was talking about the kingdom of heaven being like a landowner who went out in the morning to hire laborers in his vineyard. And you know, my brothers, just to quickly tell you what happens. This landowner goes into the vineyard early in the morning. He goes at 6 o'clock in the morning and he sees some workers and he says, come and work in my vineyard. I will pay you the wages that are required of a day's wage. I will give you 1 denarii. And they are very happy. They come at 6 o'clock. They start work. Then he goes at 9 o'clock. He gets some more workers and he begins to hire them in their vineyard. Every hour he goes at 9, he goes at 12, he goes at 3, and then he goes even at 5 o'clock, because 6 o'clock they are supposed to finish work. They work for 12 hours. When he goes at 5 o'clock, he hires people to work in his vineyard only for 1 hour. There are people who started work at 6 o'clock in the morning. Finally, when it is 6 o'clock, it's time to pay them their daily wages. He brings the people who had just worked for 1 hour at 5 o'clock and he starts giving them their daily wages. He gives the people who worked at 5 o'clock 1 denarii. He gives even the people who came at 6 o'clock in the morning also 1 denarii, which means God is not going to look at you for how long you worked. There are people who have been working for a long time and they believe that they have got extra collars. Their collars have become much tighter. They believe that, you know, they can wear the suits and boots and they can walk with their chest out because they have been serving. They have become like, you know, big stalwarts in the kingdom. You know, my brothers and sisters, in God's kingdom, it doesn't matter how long you worked. It doesn't matter how long you worked. It matters how well you worked. You can work for even 15 days. And at the end of 15 days, you can really fulfill the work, the mission that God called you to do. If you understand that you can put Jesus first in your life and you can fulfill. And therefore, even though there are people who have worked longer than you and me, and people who came just yesterday and today, and they begin to serve the Lord. And if they can understand by putting Jesus first, they also shall receive their reward. And then the last will be first. And the first will be last. Brothers and sisters, please understand, in God's kingdom, it is not dependent on how long you serve the Lord. So now that you know that it doesn't depend on how long you serve the Lord, please don't change your mind. Don't try to live a frivolous life. Don't try to live a loose life and say, I will come back at the time of retirement. Because any case, the Lord is not dependent on how long we serve. Let me have a great time. You may never have that chance to return. So don't you ever go back to a life which is away from Christ. Let this Christ in you encourage you to go and be a sharer of the good news. Let him touch your life and my life. Let us inspire us to go and share the gospel to the ends of the earth. Amen. Let us pray. Sister Joyce, let us pray.
Yes, brother. I have stopped. 1 minute. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Once again, you have served us so many truths which have transformed us and removed us from this unbelief and planted us in belief of the word, the right belief. And this is planted on good soil. And no enemy, no power can take this away. The truths we have received now, we will treasure this. And now these are the treasures of our hearts. Thank you, Father, for these truths that you have given us and helped us to apply in our daily situations, to realize that whatever we plant and whatever we sow, we will reap according to its time and type. May it take root, Lord, and produce wonderful things, things of beauty and great blessings to many. And as we leave this place now, Lord, thank you that you walk with us. May we be alert to your teachings, promptings, and let us try our best to run this race in your kingdom, Lord, so that we excel in your kingdom. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory in this age and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.